Right, basically.
Please join us in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance led by Jill Druskus, President of the Veterans Day Council of Indianapolis.
Please join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for the invocation given by Chaplain Cliff Pop, Major, Indiana National Guard.
I invite you to join me in prayer. O gracious God, on this Veterans Day, we give thanks to those who've shown the way of freedom and justice by giving their all and heeding your eternal triumphant call. We thank you, Father, for your power, for the lives of those which you have empowered in the service of our nation, for all the men and women who have given their time, their honor, and even their lives for the sake of freedom. We offer praise and thanksgiving. It was through their efforts and your grace that we persist in our freedom. We pray today, Father, that we might live to see a time when there will be no need for others to be known as veterans. We pray for the peace of our nation and of the world. We ask that you be gracious to all of those serving now, wherever they may be in this world. We pray for your blessing in their lives as we now honor them and those who went before. May all who were served and who do serve find peace and strength through your power in their lives. Lord, we ask that you bless our nation, that you bless our state, that you bless our leadership, the government level, military level, down to the company level. Bless this service today as we take time to honor and recognize those who have served in our armed forces. Now as we honor our courageous and brave, may we follow your way for that you have paved. Through our trials be different, our adventures quite varied. We honor our veterans who before us you've carried. Amen.
We now pause to remember our American POWs and MIAs still unaccounted for from all wars and conflicts. The POW-MIA flag has been placed on the empty chair as a reminder for all of us to spare no effort in securing the release of all American prisoners from captivity, the repatriation of the remains of those who died bravely in defense of liberty, and a full accounting of those still missing. Let us rededicate ourselves to this vital endeavor. Please be seated. Thank you, Chaplain Pop and Madam President Druskus. And a very special thanks to Master at Arms First Class Brosda for that beautiful rendition of our national anthem. And thank you to the Indiana National Guard's 38th Infantry Brass Quartet for that wonderful musical prelude under the direction of Sergeant Paul Mergen. Let's give them a round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2021 Veterans Day service sponsored by the Veterans Day Council of Indianapolis. This year's ceremony is very significant. Almost 2 years ago, our country and the entire globe was gripped by the COVID-19 pandemic, which prevented us from gathering together publicly. It has been a pandemic not seen since after World War I, when at that time the world battled the Spanish flu, This year, we are grateful to be gathered together today face-to-face at the beautiful Indiana War Memorial to pay tribute to our veterans. We are so fortunate to be able to return to our Indianapolis community's time-honored tradition of this Veterans Day. To everyone seated in our audience, welcome back. And to those watching the service via our live stream webcast, we are so glad to be able to share this Veterans Day with you also, and we include you in our warm welcome as well. I'm United States Air Force retired Brigadier General Stuart Goodwin, Executive Director of the Indiana War Memorial Commission, and I have been given the great honor of being your Master of Ceremonies this morning. This Veterans Day marks the 103rd anniversary year of the armistice that ended the Great War, World War I. By the end of 1918, 4.7 million Americans served in support of World War I, with more than 116,500 paying the ultimate sacrifice and another 205,000 wounded. During World War I, 135,000 Hoosiers served, and of those, 3,709 were killed in action. The overall total of deaths from the war were 67 million. And of those sacrifices, 10 million were military, 7 million were civilians, and 50 million were from the Spanish flu, which was due to poor sanitary conditions following the war. It was in 1918, at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, an armistice was signed between the Allied powers of World War I and Germany in a railroad car in Compiègne, which ceased hostilities of the Western Front of World War I. Although World War I didn't officially end until the signing of the Treaty of Versailles on June 28, 1919, the armistice of November 11th, the year before, effectively brought the Great War to its end, a long-awaited end. And it is that hour, day, and month we still recognize today, 103 years later. In 1919, President Woodrow Wilson proclaimed November 11th as Armistice Day. 7 years later, in 1926, Congress adopted a resolution requesting that President Calvin Coolidge issue annual proclamations on November 11th, making Armistice Day a legal holiday. In 1945, World War II veteran Raymond Weeks from Birmingham, Alabama, had the vision to expand Armistice Day that would celebrate all veterans, not just those who died in World War I. In 1954, Ed Reese, the U.S. representative from Emporia, Kansas, presented a bill to establish the holiday to Congress. Eisenhower, who was then the president and also from Kansas, signed the bill into law on May 26, 1954, 8.5 years after Raymond Weeks held the first Veterans Day. After our country having been through both World War II and the Korean War, the 83rd U.S. Congress, at the urge of the Veterans Service Organizations, amended the Act of 1938 by striking out the word armistice and adding the word veterans. With the approval of this legislation on June 1, 1954, November 11th became a day to honor the service of American veterans of all wars. Each year on Veterans Day, the citizens of Indianapolis pause to celebrate the men and women who have served our country while also remembering the armistice that marked the end of one of the deadliest conflicts the world has ever seen. Indianapolis and Indiana are indeed fortunate to have strong and dedicated leaders in public service. We are honored today by the presence of such leaders here on the dais. I would like to introduce them seated on the dais with us today. The Honorable Eric J. Holcomb, Governor of Indiana. The Honorable Joseph Hogsett, Mayor of Indianapolis. Indiana National Guard Adjutant General, Brigadier General R. Dale Lives. Lieutenant Commander, U.S. Coast Guard, retired, and President of the Veterans State Council of Indianapolis, Jill Druskus. The day would not be complete if we did not have the branches of the service represented in uniform with us today. Seating on the stage representing the Army is Brigadier General Lives. Seated in the center front row representing their branches of service are United States Marine Corps, CWO4 John Kiefer, United States Navy, Lieutenant Commander Luke Rayfield, Air Force, Brigadier General Kevin Doyle. Please, let's honor them with our applause. From our government services, Indiana Secretary of State Holly Sullivan, Director, Indiana Department of Veterans Affairs, Dennis Weimer, American Legion National Headquarters, Sean Long, National Treasurer, American Legion Auxiliary National Headquarters, Dr. Kelly Circle, Executive Director. World War II veteran, Army Air Corps, Bob Pettigo, B-24 Bombardier, 30 combat missions. He is with us today representing also World War II. And I can tell you that as a personal friend and a longtime supporter of veterans and the War Memorial, Bob Pettigo is 98 years old. And if you've heard us talk at all, that's why we live free today, right there. Seated in the second row behind our armed service members are representatives from our veteran service organizations, National Guard Association of Indiana, Lieutenant Colonel Michael Hall, Associate of the U.S. Army, Roger Peterman, Colonel, United States Army, retired. Senator Braun's office, we have Jacob Harka, Military and Veteran Affairs Outreach Manager, Department of Indiana American Legion, Mark Gillian, Commander, Department of Veteran of Foreign Wars, Richard Lineberry, Commander, American Veterans, Lee Williams, State Commander, Disabled American Veterans, Donald Peet, past Disabled American Veterans, Donald Peet, past State Commander. Let's give them a rousing applause. And we appreciate all of you being with us today. Ladies and gentlemen, after introducing these prominent leaders in our country, I would be remiss if I failed to acknowledge those whom we seek to honor and celebrate today, the men and women who answered the call or volunteered to serve and defend our nation and protect our freedoms by wearing the uniforms of the United States Armed Forces. American veterans who made incredible sacrifices so that all Americans may celebrate the liberties we enjoy today. I would ask that all veterans of the United States Armed Forces who are in our audience, those who served previously and those presently serving, to stand up if you're able or wave so that everyone may recognize, and this is important, we want to hear an enthusiastic approval of what they have done. Let's do it. Special guest bringing us greetings this morning is the 51st governor of the state of Indiana, a lifetime Hoosier and a Navy veteran, where he served 6 years as an intelligence officer stateside and overseas. Please welcome the Honorable Eric J. Holcomb.
Thank you, General Goodwin. Whenever you say I served in the Navy, you kind of have a smirk on your face, like there's some Air Force joke coming. Good evening, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's very good to be with you all, Madam President, General Lyles, Mayor Hogsett. It is, as you point out, General Goodwin, good to be back in person with one another to taking live the musically multi-talented members of the Armed Forces Band. You know, as you just alluded to, General Goodwin, it is every year we find ourselves here in somewhat of a formal gathering. We pay tribute annually. Some do so, I try, daily, in maybe a smaller, more informal way. And we do gather to express our gratitude for the brave women and men who have served and sacrificed so much for our very own safety and security, for our freedoms, for our love of liberty and our just the possibility to live in freedom like we do, and to gather around the table for Thanksgiving dinner here not too often in the distant future, maybe to open presents on Christmas or celebrate the new year with family and friends. And it's just never lost on me, especially in those times, how much we truly do have and how much so many have given so that we could. And as a Hoosier, I can't think of any more fitting or more appropriate place to assemble than right here inside this sacred, magnificent memorial that stands as a tribute to that very strength of our brothers and sisters who put on that uniform, who answered our nation's highest call, a call that results ultimately in a pledge to, if the circumstances require it, to lay down their lives so others might continue on. And in doing so, it's our grandparents and our parents, our sons and daughters, who reap, I know, at least one reward, and I hope they know that that reward is they are the very reason that we're able to pursue happiness, enjoy our freedoms, and this liberty we cling to. In fact, we owe it to them that this American experiment lives on. It's because of their courage, those 30 missions, or that 30 seconds that made all the difference in the world in their lives or someone they're serving with, whether it's over target or over the seas or under the surface, that we're able to stand here today and hope, and I believe that our best days are in front of us. Like I suspect many of you, I too couldn't be prouder of those who raise their right hand, who take that oath, who stencil their uniforms and lace up their boots and get at it every single day, wherever they are, here at, on the homeland or far flung around the world. I just simply stand here in awe. In awe of their, not just service, but their duty, what they're called to do, their commitment to our country. And I know, as evidenced here and by the hundreds or thousands that are streaming in watching, in fact, I'm not alone. And that's why I'm equally proud of our state. State that not only sends more than our fair share, General Lyles, you remind me, keep me informed and updated. We send more than our fair share of patriots to serve. But we're also a state of 6.8 million citizens who aren't in uniform, who revere those who are. And I'm constantly reminded of that fact as I state, no matter how big the city or how small the town. I'm reminded that, yes, God did shed his grace on me, no matter what road I'm on, no matter what cemetery I might find myself in. When you're looking at the actual story and realizing the life of that Revolutionary War veteran, looking at that headstone and learning about what they meant to not just that town or family, but to our country. And that dates back as to the Revolutionary War through both of the Great Wars, all the way up to Corporal Sanchez from Logan's Fort, back from Kabul. I'm reminded when I have the honor to shake the hand of a World War II veteran, or stand in the presence of someone who served in Vietnam. I can't even imagine the courage that it took on a daily basis. And what really warms my heart, is when I see a young person salute these men and women in their own way. And I'll just share one quick recent story that was shared with me. It came from a Navy captain, a surgeon assigned to duty down at Cap Atterbury. The captain wrote to our commissioner at the Indiana Department of Health. Just a quick note, this is just a couple weeks ago, and he wrote, "Chris, this morning as I was leaving my hotel and getting coffee, this adorable young man, probably 16, attending the Future Farmers of America event, insisted on buying me coffee since I was in uniform." It continues to amaze me the level of Hoosier hospitality in the state. Our team has never been treated with such respect. I just wanted to once again thank you, your team, and your state's populace for your generosity. This is a young man, maybe 16, insisting on buying a U.S. Navy captain a cup of coffee just to say thanks. We're raising them right. And this is what I know our best days are indeed ahead of us. And so to every veteran out there, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for dedicating some of the best years of your life, giving them to your country, sacrificing so much so that our nation can endure and stand as strong and long as this Indiana limestone. God bless you all.
Thank you, Governor Holcomb, for that thoughtful message to our Hoosier veterans, and thank you for your continued service to our state and nation. Another special guest bringing us a Veteran Day greeting this morning on behalf of the citizens of the city of Indianapolis, I'm pleased to introduce Mayor Joseph Hogsett. Mayor Hogsett is a lifelong Hoosier, a former federal prosecutor, and has deep roots in the city of Indianapolis for more than three decades. Mayor Hogsett assumed office in 2016 as the 49th mayor of the city of Indianapolis. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Indianapolis Mayor, the Honorable Joseph Hogsett.
Well, thank you, General Goodwin, to Governor Holcomb, General Lyles, and all veterans joining us for today's ceremony. Governor, I think your remarks were incredibly appropriate and thoughtful. I want to amend one thing that you said. or didn't say, actually. You just left out, I mean, you gave us so many special holidays that are upcoming where we celebrate Thanksgiving, Veterans Day, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's. There's a holiday, though, that you left out that I think it's appropriate that we remind ourselves of, and many of you have probably heard me say this before, but my grandfather, George Hogsett, was a veteran of the Great War. He was Army. And my father, Richard Hogsett, was a veteran of World War II. He called it the Big One. And he was Navy. So in the Hogsett household, we also celebrated the holiday known as the Army-Navy game. That's upcoming in a couple of weeks. And I don't want to leave that out. To all Army and Navy, as well as all veterans, thank you for your service. You know, the impulse to serve on behalf of the safety and security of others is the greatest impulse among a freedom-loving people. It means that our liberty, our democracy, our very freedom is ours only by the grace of our fellow Americans. That link is the very essence of our nation's motto. Out of many, one. Each year on this day, we recognize veterans for the services they have or that they will continue to render to the common cause of American liberty. Our city, of course, distinguishes itself as unique in displays of our appreciation for those who have served and are serving and will serve. In the spirit of that legacy, it's my privilege once again to present a proclamation to General Goodwin on behalf of the city of Indianapolis in honor of Veterans Day. I'll read it. It is brief, but meaningful. In 1938, legislation was passed establishing November 11 as Armistice Day in the United States in homage to the conclusion of World War I. In 1954, as General Goodwin recited, the United States Congress amended the Act of 1938 so that November 11 would become a day to honor American veterans of all wars, establishing the nationally recognized Veterans Day. The credit for our freedom and our continued security overwhelmingly belongs to the service members of our nation's armed forces. And the city of Indianapolis is dedicated to honoring our veterans by paying tribute to their bravery and their heroism, as well as providing resources and care that aid in their well-being during and after service to our country. Today, the citizens of Indianapolis join together to honor veterans who have served throughout our nation's history and reaffirm our commitment to supporting those who have made sacrifices for the liberty and the freedom of our country. And so it is that now, as the mayor of the city of Indianapolis, I am proud to hereby proclaim November 11, 2021, as Veterans Day in the city of Indianapolis. And I ask all residents of our city to join with me in this observation. General.
Thank you, Mayor Hogsett. We are so honored to have you join us today. Our keynote speaker today is Brigadier General R. Dale Lyles, who currently serves as the 59th Adjutant General of Indiana. Before becoming Adjutant General on October 1st, 2019, General Lyles served as the Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations at National Guard Bureau, Arlington, Virginia. A native of Salem, Indiana, General Lyles earned his bachelor's degree in business from Indiana University in 1989 and was a 1994 graduate of the Indiana Military Academy, where he received his commission. Additionally, General Lyles holds a master's degree in management from Oakland City University and a master's degree from the U.S. Army War College in strategic studies. General Lyles has held multiple command and staff positions throughout the last 25 years, including serving as the plans and operation officer at Camp Atterbury, Indiana, Indiana Army National Guard, recruiting and retention operations and training officer. He has also served as brigade operations officer, commander, and executive officer over multiple commands throughout his career. His operational deployments include serving as a company commander with the 151 Infantry in Bosnia and as the administrative officer, S1, with the 76th Infantry Brigade in Afghanistan. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker to the podium, the Adjutant General of Indiana, Brigadier General R. Dale Lyles.
Thank you for those kind words, Stu. We need to talk afterwards. That's way too much about me. So. Well, Governor, Mayor, thank you, too, for your kind words. Sir, thank you for your service. And indeed, it's my privilege to be here this morning to address such a fine audience of great Americans. And so I think we have with us today not only veterans who have served, we also have military members of the United States Armed Forces that are currently serving. And I notice we have some of our brothers from our NATO country here as well. As well as that, we also have a few Gold Star family members in the audience too. And for that, it is my humble and honor, privilege to be here today to address such a great audience. Today is the day we honor you and give thanks for your service and commitment to our state and nation. Because of you, the United States is the greatest country in which to live, raise a family, and to worship the God of our choosing. Because of your willingness to sacrifice for the common good, our nation and our people remain free. And I want to share a couple of things with you that I have learned over the last week. Over the last week, I've had the opportunity to attend multiple veterans events as well as Gold Star family events. And I've learned a couple of things. Our veterans and our Gold Star families only require two things of us. And those things are not sorrow or pity or things of that sort or finances, but rather they are this. And they are two things that we should take from here and continue to strive as we deepen our resolve to make this country the greatest country in which to live. The first is that we recognize that our veterans and that those who have given the ultimate sacrifice for this country was not given in vain. And the second is that we never forget. That we never forget our veterans, and that we never forget those who shed their blood for our very cause of democracy and freedom. And so it's only fitting, as highlighted by the governor, that we conduct this ceremony at the Indiana War Memorial. The Indiana War Memorial, to me, embodies both of those two things that our veterans and that our Gold Star families ask of us. These monuments, this theater where these speeches are declared, are indeed testament to the reason why we serve. The statues and the monuments that reveal the names of those that have fallen in behalf of our country and our freedom recognize 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, those that have given the ultimate sacrifice. These monuments also indicate that these service members who have served and given their lives did not do so in vain. As the governor indicated on the 11th hour, or I'm sorry, as General Goodwin indicated, on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, hostilities of World War I formally concluded. When the armistice with Germany went into effect, the Great War was over and the Allies' victory was secured. American forces had suffered losses of more than 116,500 over 4 years of deadly conflict. And indeed, as General Goodwin said, the Spanish flu of 1918, a pandemic, also claimed thousands of lives. Soldiers from our own 38th Infantry Division, headquartered here in Indianapolis, who had deployed in the fight for our state and country's freedom, were soon headed home from this war. And what I would like to do now is, I would like to highlight some of the things that the Indiana National Guard and all of the National Guard and all of our services have done for the 54 states and territories over the last 2 years. And what I want to do in capturing a few of these accomplishments is this. These accomplishments will go down in history as saving millions of lives. These accomplishments will go down in history as preserving this very freedom that we enjoy each and every day. And we only achieve these accomplishments on the backs of our veterans. Our veterans and our Gold Star families and all of the sacrifices that you have done, whether it be World War II, Korean War, the Vietnam War, or whatever war that you served in or whatever time you served, we were able to accomplish these missions because of the standards that you set and the things that you did during your tenure serving your country. So after the 1918 World War I and the armistice was signed, the mood was optimistic despite the pandemic. The 1918 pandemic and the ongoing public health crisis and the resulting quarantines, restrictions, and closures. This was the war to end all wars, and many years thereafter, November the 11th indeed became Veterans Day. But the ideal of an enduring global peace was short-lived. In the coming decades, our nation would engage in more deadly conflicts, including World War II and Korea in 1954. In recognition of the Second World War and the greatest mobilization of our armed forces in our nation's history, our government indeed recognizes November the 11th as Veterans Day to honor all American veterans of all wars. Since then, American armed forces have fought on many other fronts, including Vietnam, Afghanistan, and Iraq. Some of you here today served in these and other conflicts. You swore the oath to protect and defend our freedoms, and a grateful state and nation salute you here today. As the Adjutant General, I am responsible for making sure the citizen soldiers and citizen airmen of the Indiana National Guard are ready to serve both state and federal missions at a moment's notice. This is a critical time in a very unstable world. And we must be ready to respond to both natural and man-made emergencies. The National Guard's motto is always ready, always there. Over the past year, we have demonstrated that promise on many fronts, an unprecedented, integrated, and historic response to local and national events, including pandemic relief, combating cyber threats and disinformation, assisting the Department of Homeland Security with resettling Afghan evacuees at Camp Atterbury, securing the Capital Region on January the 6th, as well as deploying multiple companies to Okonis missions, as well as here in the United States. Moreover, every one of you here today has been affected in some way by COVID-19. Yet, despite the inherent dangers, members of the Indiana National Guard and the National Guard throughout the United States, we continue to be here at the forefront of Governor Holcomb's and the 54 state and territory governors and leadership to fight and defend this country against the pandemic and against those that seek to do us harm. Indiana was chosen as one of the first states for a pilot to give the vaccine to its soldiers and to its citizens. More than 1,500 guardsmen responded to the long-term care facilities to help fight the virus that were spreading in those facilities and compelling almost half of the deaths that were occurring early in the pandemic. We provided COVID tests at 25 armories throughout the state. To date, we have given approximately, we have provided 12 locations and helped 51.4 million meals to be distributed throughout Indiana at the food banks. Throughout the state, Indiana Guardsmen have helped distribute personal protective equipment to schools, hospitals, and including 2.2 million protective masks, 160,000 bottles of hand sanitizer, and 2.8 million pairs of gloves and masks. Indiana Guardsmen are actively assisting now in over 14 hospitals to help with staffing issues. We've transported over 3,300 COVID tests to be processed at different facilities. And for 81 days, Indiana Guardsmen collaborated with the State Department of Health, NIU, at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway at the mass vaccination and testing mission that provided tens of thousands with these services. According to one news story, Governor Holcomb said that the effort was like watching one giant pit crew. At the same time, we are constantly working with the state and federal agencies to combat cybersecurity threats and misinformation. Last October, we stood up the 127th Cyber Battalion, and it is currently deployed conducting cyber protection and operations throughout the world. The Indiana National Guard is providing ongoing support to Operation Allies Welcome at Camp Atterbury as we seek to resettle over 7,000 Afghan evacuees that have been displaced from Kabul, Afghanistan after the Taliban reclaimed control in that country. At the request of local and federal civil law enforcement authorities, we responded to the National Capital Region, where we sent two battalions from Fort Wayne and New Albany, Indiana, to help preserve freedom in our nation's capital. These missions represent 21st century challenges, and to ensure the Indiana National Guard is up to the task, we must be diligent in building and managing and maintaining a 21st century fighting force that prioritizes our people and our organization first, who are the backbone and the foundation of everything that we do. Again, I highlight all of these things that we have done throughout the state of Indiana and throughout the United States as being successful operations because of the conditions that were set by the men and women who have served and who have served as veterans, our great nation, and the different services. We were able to accomplish all of those things because of your service and setting the conditions for that. I applaud each and every one of you. To all of our veterans and to our Gold Star families who are here today, you can indeed rest assured that we will never forget the cause of freedom, and for which you served. We will never forget your names. We will also ensure, by having things like today on Veterans Day, that your service member did not give his life or her life in vain, and that your service was for a greater purpose than I, a greater purpose for our country. And with that, God bless each and every one of you for what you've done for your country, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you, General Lyles, for that wonderful Veterans Day message, and thank you for your honorable service to our state and nation. We have now come to that portion of our program that symbolizes what this Veterans Day service is all about, a special celebration of all who have ever proudly worn a uniform of the United States Armed Forces. With the assistance of the ceremonial unit, our keynote speaker, Brigadier General Lyles, will place a celebratory victory wreath in tribute of the proud military service given by all veterans of all branches during all eras in the defense of these great United States of America. Thank you. As a further tribute to celebrate all honored veterans of past and present, the ship's bell from the USS Indianapolis CA-35 will toll to commemorate the proud service of all veterans in each war era that has involved our nation's armed forces. The Revolutionary War. The War of 1812. The War with Mexico. The American Civil War. The Spanish-American War. World War I. World War II. The Korean War. The Vietnam War. The Cold War. The Persian Gulf War. The Global War on Terrorism. Let us now pause to pay respect to those veterans who are not with us today. Those whose ultimate sacrifice is a debt that we as Americans can never fully repay. If you are able, please rise and join me as we give the ship's bell a final toll in solemn remembrance of all of our nation's fallen heroes, followed by this moment of silence. You may be seated. At patriotic and veteran events, it is customary to pay honor to each branch of the U.S. Armed Forces by proudly playing the service anthem, performed today by the Indiana National Guard's 38th Infantry Brass Quintet, is the United States Armed Forces Service Medley. Veterans and active duty service members, we invite you to stand proudly when your service anthem is played.
Thank you.
Please stand and uncover as we again call upon Chaplain Pop for our benediction.
I invite you to join me in prayer. Lord, we again are grateful for the opportunity and the freedom we have to gather and honor our nation's veterans. We ask a special blessing on them and their families for the service they have given to our country. Though many may not see more of tomorrow, they have not lived in vain, nor in tragic sorrow, but rather in peace. They have won the real prize to new dawns. With you, their souls do arise. They defended this land with dignity and pride on the wings of eagles and angels. They ride to be near you, creator and friend, examples of life without end. As we go about today, may we honor our veterans and all that we do. Bless us as we depart. May your love and grace be visible in all of our lives for all to see. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain Pop. On behalf of the Veterans Day Council of Indianapolis, we thank you for attending today's service and your support. It is ceremonies like today that allow us to gather and show appreciation to our veterans who served and sacrificed for our community, state, and nation. It is the service of veterans that remind us freedom is not free. Upon the retirement of the colors, this will conclude our service. Until then, stay healthy and well, and we look forward to seeing you next year. And I want to leave you with a thought today, and I believe the thought represents all of us, and we need to send this message. Real heroes don't save the world, they serve the world. Please retire the colors.
Thank you again for joining us today.